So though there is no name by called a perjury in Indian Penal Code, it speaks about offences relating or against public justice. It's a concept by name called perjury, which gives giving false evidence. So giving and fabricating false evidence, that is what we are going to discuss today. And why this chapter is most important is that this is the one of the chapter where it prescribes death sentence. So in out of 511 sections, as I told you already, from section 121 to 511, now there are only limited sections which prescribes death sentence. And this is one of the chapter which prescribes death sentence when it comes to an this particular giving or fabricating false evidence when it relates to the heinous crime. So I'm just sharing the screen now with respect to the slides and other things. Okay, so of offences relating to false evidence and public justice, this is what the thing what we are going to discuss today. So as I told you, this is again and one of the important chapter which covers in Indian Penal Code, and this is something a broad division of law which speaks about giving and taking or giving or fabricating false evidence. It covers from section 191 to 229A of Indian Penal Code. It covers both giving and fabricating. So it is not try to escape, or it gives the differentiation between what you mean by giving and what you mean by fabricating. So both the elements has been covered in this particular chapter. And it includes the harboring of offenders also, and some deviant acts of the public servant with intention of screening or making them to move away from the clutches of law. All these things covered in this offences relating to public justice and false evidence. So this 191 and 192, it speaks about the element of giving and fabricating false evidence. It's a distinguishment between giving and taking false evidence. So it speaks about three important elements. If you check into this, three important elements has been discussed in this. One is legally bound by an oath. Whoever the person, if he is legally bound by oath or by an express provision of law. So for example, if he being the witness, or if he is being the expert, or if he is being the police officer, or if he is being any person who is being made that authority to give some evidence or give some information, are bound by law to make declaration. So it may be the commissioner of oath or notary publics or anyone else. So these persons are comes within the ambit of this 191, where it says that whether these persons who are legally bound by giving an information. So here information, it may be the information or it may be the statement which having the capacity of converting it into evidence. So here it is not simply the statement, it is the thing where it is going to be taken into consideration as evidence. So fabricating false evidence illa giving false evidence pathona inga statement o illa or writing o illa or recording o da irukum, but adu enna irukapodu not simply statement a irukaporadilla or simply recording of statement a irukaporadilla adu enna agudhu or evidentiary value va convert agapodu. அந்த எவிடென்ஷரி வேல்யூவை கன்வெர்ட் ஆகும் போது அதுக்கு அங்கே எவிடென்ஷரி வேல்யூ இருக்கு, அட்மிசபிலிட்டி இருக்கு, அதனுடைய கான்சிக்வன்சஸ் ஒரு பனிஷ்மெண்ட்டுக்கு போய் லீட் பண்ணும். அப்படி இருக்கிறதுக்கு மட்டும்தான் என்ன பண்றாங்க இங்க பனிஷ்மெண்ட்ஸ் கொடுக்கற மாதிரியான செக்ஷன்ஸ் கொடுக்குறாங்க. ஸோ இன் சச் அ வே மேக்ஸ் எனி ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட். ஸோ இந்த ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட் ஹியர் இட் ஸ்டேட்டட் நாட் சிம்பிளி அ ஸ்டேட்மெண்ட், ஹியர் தி இம்போசஸ் த மென்ஸ்ரியா த இன்டென்ஷனல் பார்ட். வாட் இட் சேஸ், either he believes, the person who makes the statement believes or knows to be false or not true. So he has the intention first of all, and he is having the knowledge what he is going to tell false. So what is the difference between telling false and not to be true? So not to be true is that what he is stating is something other than the fact is not to be true. False is either he may giving that another version. If he knows about it, he comes and state that, no, I don't know about it. So this is false. And this is comes within the giving false evidence. Fabricating false evidence is that who is having the capacity or authority of creating or making some document or records or any other matter which going to be the part and parcel of the evidence, there he makes any false entry in such a book or record, or including the electronic records also. So as we are living in the electronic or digital era, now we are being within this electronic record. So when compared to the traditional modem of giving or entry into a book and making an entry to the electronic or digital modem, it's something different, because unless otherwise you could go and change the settings regarding the date, time and other thing. It is not possible. But for example, like sending mail or sending SMS or sending this WhatsApp, nowadays become a very big issue whether WhatsApp is safe, whether cybersecurity is there in the WhatsApp, other things are going within it. So in such a case, making some alteration in the electronic records also. Intended to appear such false circumstances or false entry in a judicial proceedings, that is the most important thing here, not simply making this false or fabricating false evidence, with the intention and with the knowledge that in consequences it is going to be placed before the court of law, either being the judicial proceedings trial or before the arbitral proceedings as an evidence. So it is going to have a concept, it is going to have a validity of evidence. So that is the thing comes within this 191 and 192. And 193 speaks about the punishment for both giving and fabricating false evidence. So it speaks about the punishment is which may extend to 7 years with or without fine at any stage of the judicial proceedings. So the maximum period here, if you could see, other than death sentences, the three types of punishment will cover in Indian Penal Code under this chapter: 7 years, 5 years and 3 years. It will repeat again and again. In some cases, it's only in two sections, it's prescribed death sentence or the sentence prescribed for the particular offense if it got punished. So this is comes within this fabricating or giving false evidence. Then section 194 speaks about the with an intention of giving false evidence, what sort of intention this false evidence may lead to procure capital sentence or like imprisonment for life or any other term of imprisonment. So this is 194. So the person at the time of giving this false evidence, he is having the intention and he is having the knowledge that this false evidence will lead to a conviction, not a simple conviction, conviction of death sentence. So as I told you earlier, section 194 is punishable with the death sentence, one of the gravest offense according to the Indian Penal Code. So he is having the intention and he is having the knowledge. And if it is being executed, so based on the false evidence or for fabricated false evidence, conviction has been passed. Not only the conviction has been passed, it is also executed. So, ஒருத்தனுக்கு வந்து டெத் சென்டென்ஸ் கொடுக்கக்கூடிய அஃபென்ஸ் சார்ஜ்ல ஒரு ட்ரையல் நடந்துட்டு இருக்கு. அந்த ட்ரையல்ல ஒரு எவிடன்ஸ் கொடுக்க போறான். அந்த எவிடன்ஸ் கொடுக்கும் போது அவனுக்கு என்ன எந்த இன்டென்ஷன்ல போறான், இந்த எவிடன்ஸ் கொடுத்தா கண்டிப்பா அவனுக்கு கன்விக்ஷன் கிடைக்கும், அந்த கன்விக்ஷன் டெத் சென்டென்ஸா தான் இருக்கும் அப்படின்னு தெரிஞ்சும் ஃபால்ஸ் எவிடன்ஸ் கொடுக்குறான். அந்த ஃபால்ஸ் எவிடன்ஸை பேஸ் பண்ணி தான் அவனுக்கு அங்க டெத் சென்டென்ஸ் கொடுத்து அது எக்ஸிக்யூட் ஆயிடுச்சுன்னா, யார் இந்த ஃபால்ஸ் எவிடன்ஸ் கொடுத்தாங்களோ அவங்களுக்கும் டெத் சென்டென்ஸ் தான் இருக்கு செக்ஷன் 194ல. சோ 195 ஸ்பீக்ஸ் அபவுட் another provision. So if it is executed and if it is not executed, they are segregating the punishment, the depending upon the gravity or the consequences or the intensity of the false evidence, they are say part 1 if it is executed, part 2 if it is not executed. So this is the punishment which covered in section 194. If the intention is to convict it for imprisonment for life, the sentence is 7 years of imprisonment. So if it is not executed, it is imprisonment for life or 10 years of rigorous imprisonment. If it is not executed, it is 7 years of imprisonment. And the next is threatening to give false evidence. So what is this threatention of giving false evidences? A threatens B with a dire consequences to give false evidence. So here he is not the person who is going to give false evidence. He is making use of other to come and give false evidence. So the threatention may be of any injury to his reputation or to his property or to any other person who is entrusted with. So if A being threatening B that unless he comes and gives false evidence, he will kill his son or he will kill his kids or he will cause some bad reputation towards his dignity in the society, or he may cause destruction to the property, he will cause damage to his property. So this is this thing where it speaks about threatening under section 195A of the Indian Penal Code. So here the threatention already been covered in 506 part 2. Criminal intimidation is also there. But here the special intention is the threatention is with the intention of giving false evidence. So it is not simply the threatention. The concept, the ulterior motive of threatention is to give false evidence where it is punishable up to 7 years of imprisonment with or without fine. And it is continuing based on this false evidence. So A threatens B to give false evidence against C. So C is an innocent person. Based on the evidence given by B on the retention of A leads to conviction to C. So here A is eligible or liable to get punishment for more than 7 years if it is a basis on the death or imprisonment for life. So here, who can claim this? So the major question is, who can file a complaint against this person, who Mr. A, that he under his retention only B gave a false evidence or false giving the evidence which is against the knowledge or intention. So it has to be either raised by B or by C. So it is not by the police or by the prosecution. So they have to give a complaint against the person who threatened or who gave a false evidence. So this chapter will not mixed with malicious prosecution. So this is not a malicious prosecution or this is not a false prosecution. So here it speaks about someone with an intention giving false evidence and out of it somebody got injured. And the person who got injured out of the false evidence given by someone has to give a complaint. It may be like a counter complaint against the person who made this or gave this false evidence. And this one is using false evidence known to be false. So I know that and I'm what I'm giving is false, or I make it or attempted to give the evidence which is not true according to my knowledge, or it is not genuine according to my knowledge, or I know or I have a reason to believe that it is a fabricated one. So here they are involving 3 to 4 type of mental intention, mens rea here. So one is with knowledge, with the intention, with known reason to believe. So all they are stressing, they are bringing out, they are extracting to show that with the strong conviction, with the strong intention and knowledge only he is using what the statement which is not true according to his knowledge as a true before the court of law according to section 196. So what is the punishment for 196? I told you in the first slide itself, the punishment will cover under section 193, which means 7 years of imprisonment if it is ended in consequences. And another one is it speaks about issuing or signing false certificate. So it is not false signature, it is not issuing a false certificate, but it is the thing where the person who is having the authority or capacity, or he is the person who is in the capacity of issuing such a certificate. He is issuing the false certificate or signing the false certificate by knowing that it is false. And he is a person who required to sign in it. So signing in the birth certificate, signing in the death certificate, signing in a medical certificate, signing any contact certificate, signing any commission of inquiry. So in such a way, he is the person who is there to sign in the certificate. But he knows that the content or the substances in the certificate or the document is not true. And he has the reason to believe that it is not a genuine one. In spite of that, if he signs in it, then he is committing the offense under section 197. And 198 speaks about certificate using the false certificate as a true. So the preceding section 197 is signing. and 198 is using the certificate as a true certificate. We are coming across several cases in this. So recently in NEET exams also, and recently even last year NEET exam, several person has been caught hold of issuing the fake or forged or fabricated. It covers this 197 and 198. So attempt correctly uses or attempt to use any certificate as a use a true certificate, but which is false according to their knowledge. They know very well what they are using is a fake one or a false one, or the or it may be the not a genuine one, or it is a fabricated one. So this is 198. We can take a help of this NEET and other thing. And 199 is making false statement in the declaration. So declaration, we know that giving some undertaking or authorization or recognizing something, registering something, the entire content or the entire substances of the material fact is going to be based on the declaration. We are filing this affidavit, or we are filing this type of setup document. We are making the declaration that is true to the best of my knowledge. What would happen if I submit or if I produce any fake document which is not true according to my knowledge, but I'm giving the declaration that I'm submitting, I'm giving the document which is true according to the best of my knowledge. It is 199. So giving false certificate, producing before the court or producing before any forum or producing before any proceedings. So here it is the declaration. It is not about the material. It is about the declaration. By knowing very well it is not true, but I'm giving that where it having the capacity of admissibility of evidence. So this is the most important question here. Receiving benefit out of it or receiving any grant out of it is something different. But if it is having any evidentiary value, in spite of that, if I'm giving any false description or false declaration, I'm coming under section 199. Again, it is punishable as under section 193, that is 7 years of imprisonment. So the next one is using false declaration as true with the knowledge. So the false declaration genuine by knowing very well it is not true, it is a fabricated one, it is a false one. By knowing very well, if I'm used that, coming under this section 200. And 201, again a most important provision which is very serious in nature. It speaks about screening of evidence or concealing of evidence or disappearance of evidence or causing disappearance of evidence or giving false evidence to screen offender. So it is a piece of evidence, it is a matter relating to the offense which has been already committed, or if it is being the offender, by knowing very well, making that evidence to be disappeared. So for example, after committing the murder, burying the dead body or destroying the dead body or destroying the evidence in the scene of crime, or after committing any of the cyber crime, deleting the entire records that it has been, which shows that you are committing the hacking or phishing or spoofing. Then if it is a case of theft, means selling out the property or converting the jewels into ingot. So this is the thing where it speaks about causing disappearance of evidence or giving false evidence to screen the offender. இது நிறைய இடத்துல வரும். இப்ப மர்டர்ல பாத்தீங்கன்னா அந்த டெட் பாடி கிடைக்க கூடாது, அந்த கார்பஸ் கிடைக்க கூடாது அப்படிங்கிறதுக்காக மர்டர் பண்ணதுக்கு அப்புறம் அதை வந்து பேர்ன் பண்ணி ஆஷஸ் ஆக்கிடுறது, இல்லைன்னா வந்து அதை டீகம்போஸ், அதாவது யாருன்னே கண்டுபிடிக்க முடியாத மாதிரி அதை வந்து டீகம்போஸ் ஆக்கிறது, இல்லைன்னா அதை வந்து எங்கேயாவது யாருக்குமே தெரியாத இடத்துல வந்து புதைச்சிடுறது. ஸோ இதெல்லாம் என்னது அப்படின்னா இந்த காசிங் டிஸ்அப்பியரன்ஸ் டு த எவிடன்ஸ். அண்ட் திஸ் வாஸ் ஹேப்பன்ட் இன் திஸ் Nirbhaya case also. In some of the sexual offenses case also, they will try to destroy the evidence after committing the sexual offense. It also coming under section 201. And it includes the screening of offender. So screening of offender is concealing the offender. So olichu vekkirathu, marakkirathu. இதுக்கு அவங்களுக்கு வந்து அந்த அவங்களுக்கு அந்த லீகல் ப்ரொசீடிங்ஸ்ல இருந்து, லீகல் பனிஷ்மெண்ட்ல இருந்து அவங்களை வெளியில எடுத்துட்டு வரணும், அவங்களை உள்ள கொண்டு போக கூடாது அப்படிங்கிற இன்டென்ஷனோட ஸ்கிரீன் பண்றது. So giving false evidence with knowledge and screening the offender, if the offense is punishable with a death sentence, it is punishable up to 7 years of imprisonment. And if it is an offense punishable with imprisonment for life, na 3 years of imprisonment, and other offenses, na the 1/4 of the maximum sentence prescribed for that offense. This is section 201. So whenever because for 302 with an intention or read with section 201 in the sense, sometimes it may leads to severity of punishment also. So 202 is intentional omission to give an information bound to inform. So we already discussed in the first class itself what it is about is what is crime. Crime is nothing but an act or omission. So act is an obligation, what I should not do something which is prohibited by law. And omission is an obligation which I ought to do, but I omitted to do, which ended in some legal injury to the others. This is the thing. So 202 speaks about illegal omission or intentional omission. I know very well, I am very, very well aware of the fact, and I am very well acquitted of the facts and circumstances of the case. And if I've been called for any inquiry or any preliminary inquiry or any other commission, but I am not giving that information which I bound to give the information, so I am committing the offense which is punishable under section 193. 203 speaks about giving false information respecting an offense already committed. So 202, the difference between 202 and 203 is either we can take it in such a way, about to commit and already committed. So already committed in the sense, I know such offense has committed, or I'm having the reason to believe that such an offense has been committed, but I'm not giving any information. So for example, there was a robbery next to my house, in my neighbor's house or adjacent to my house, but there was an enmity between myself and that person. So I don't want to give information, but I know who actually committed, and I'm having the knowledge who actually committed that. But when police come for the investigation and police ask for the statement under section 161, I simply state that I don't know, but I know about it. Or in another way, so I'm the person or who has committed the offense, or I'm the person who is being knows about the fact. That's what this section 201, 202 and 203 speaks about, some specific offenses also, like offenses relating to murder, offenses relating to culpable homicide not amounting to murder. Then 382 is robbery, then extortion and extortion with murder. Then 402 is cheating and misrepresentation. So these sorts of offenses, more particularly, if anyone bound to give any information, but if they are intentionally omitting to give such information, are covered under section 201, 202 and 203. So there are in some cases, in some perspective, you could see IPC to facilitate the investigation. IPC to make the investigation smoothly in a direct manner, they themselves will give the clue. And this is one of the clue. The sections which has been mentioned in this in section 203 is a clue to the investigating agency. So 204 is destroying or with intention, or causing any other damage with intention to prevent such evidence before the court. So they know very well that if it is being produced, definitely it will end in conviction, or it may end in any other punishment. So with such a intention, if anyone destroys, so either thing enna panikala mischief kuda kuda neenga vandu confuse panikka venda mischief namakku oru provision irukku ena vandu causing destruction to the property adu vera inga destruction abingiradhu enna na adu vandu oru piece of evidence a irukku adu vandu court la produce panna kandipa avangalukku punishment kedaikum abingira stage la enna pandrathu adha destroy pandrathu so illana secrets marachi vekkiradhu வெளியில தெரியாம இல்ல யாருக்கும் கொடுக்காம மறைச்சு வைக்கிறது. சோ எனி ஃபார்ம் ஆஃப் ரெக்கார்ட், இட் மே பி த சே, ஒரு இஃப் இட் இஸ் பீங் அ ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி டிஸ்பியூட், கன்சீலிங் ஆர் டெஸ்ட்ராயிங் த சேல் டீட், ஆர் எனி இஃப் இட் இஸ் அ மணி டிஸ்பியூட், அ ப்ராமிசரி நோட், ஆர் எனி அதர் அண்டர்டேக்கிங், if it relates to any other instruments not destroying or secreting such a document. Or if, nowadays, if recently, we could see that a TV actress, Ms. Chitra has committed suicide. And there was a news coming in everything that her WhatsApp messages has been destroyed. But it has been retrieved by the cyber security cell. So, but if it is in a retrieved manner, if it is possible to get back the records, then the person coming under section 204 also. What would happen if it has been in an untraceable, where it is not possible to retrieve it back, then you can't expect that. So here 204 speaks about that kind of evidence. So retrieve panna mudiyada. திரும்பி கொண்டு வர முடியாத எவிடன்சஸ் வந்து டெஸ்ட்ராய் பண்றாங்க, பேப்பர்ல இருக்கு இல்ல வேற ஃபார்ம்ல இருக்கு, அப்ப அதெல்லாம் டெஸ்ட்ராய் பண்றாங்க அப்படின்னா அது செக்ஷன் 204ல வருது. And it says that lawfully compelled to produce as evidence in a court or proceedings before any public servant. So if it is being namakku vandu we could see that search and seizure la kuda paathirpom. அதுல வந்து எக்ஸப்ட் தி போஸ்டல் டெலிகிராஃப் டிபார்ட்மெண்ட் தவிர மத்த எல்லாத்தையுமே நம்ம என்ன பண்ணலாம், வி கேன் சம்மன் தெம் டு கம் அண்ட் ப்ரொடியூஸ் தட் டாக்குமெண்ட். ஸோ அப்படி ஒரு நமக்கு ஒரு சம்மன் கொடுக்க போறாங்க அண்டர் செக்ஷன் 91 சிஆர்பிசி ஆர் அண்டர் செக்ஷன் 311 சிஆர்பிசி, வேர் ஐ மைட் ஹவ் பீன் இன் அ பொசிஷன் டு கோ அண்ட் ப்ரொடியூஸ் விச் மே இன் டர்ன் வேர் தி ஆர்டர்ஸ் மே கோ அகேன்ஸ்ட் ஹிம் அப்படின்னு இருந்தது, அகேன்ஸ்ட் மை செல்ஃப் இருந்ததுன்னா டெஸ்ட்ராய் பண்றது. ஸோ ஆப்லிட்ரேட் அப்படின்னா டெஸ்ட்ராய் தான், or making which is not in a or usable adu use panna mudiyadha or condition ku maatradhu, or renders illegible the whole or part of such record. So illegible is that if it is not possible to destroy, if it is been in any other manner. So ipo vandu or x-ray irukalam illa vandu vera edhaadhu irukalam adala vandu crush pandradhu. So crush pandradha enna panna mudiyadhu, adu use pannave mudiyadhu, adu evidence ah paaka mudiyadhu. Ipo vandu or cd la irukku இல்லைனா வந்து ஒரு ரெக்கார்டிங்ல இருக்குன்னா சிடி வந்து ஸ்கிராச் பண்ணிட்டோம்னா அந்த சிடியை நம்மளால திரும்ப யூஸ் பண்ண முடியாது. இல்ல வந்து சிசிடிவி ஃபுட்டேஜ் இருக்கு, அப்ப அந்த ஃபுட்டேஜுக்கு வந்து 10 days தான் அதுக்கு பேக்கப் இருக்கு அப்படின்னா 10th, 11th day வந்து நம்ம அது வந்து எரேஸ் ஆனதுக்கு அப்புறம் நம்ம சொல்றது. ஸோ இதெல்லாம் நமக்கு 204ல கவர் ஆகுது, விச் இஸ் பனிஷபிள் அப் டு 2 years வித் ஆர் விதவுட் ஃபைல். அண்ட் நெக்ஸ்ட் ஒன் இஸ் ஃபால்ஸ் பர்சனேஷன் இன் சூட் ஆர் ப்ரொசீடிங். ஸோ பர்சனேஷன் யூ ஆல் நோ வெரி வெல், acting as somebody else, pretending as somebody else. So he is not a person. Mr. A is pretending himself as Mr. X before the court of law to receive the judgment. So actually he is not Mr. A there. He is actually Mr. Z. அதாவது வேற ஒருத்தங்க மாதிரி பர்சனேட் பண்றது கோர்ட் ப்ரொசீடிங்ஸ்ல இல்ல சூட்ல. சோ நாட் ஓன்லி பர்சனேட்டிங் தெம், through that personation making some admission or statement or confession. So with the intention that by way of appearing before the court in the place of other or in the name of other, not to receive something but to give some statement, but to give some confession or to make the admission, where that statement or admission or confession may leads to issuance of any process, which means any summons or warrant or anything else. So in such a case, then the person coming within this. So you could have asked, so where is the question of false evidence here? So that's what the chapter says about public justice also. So public justice is nothing but natural justice. So causing or destructing the actual remedy which is eligible to given to other has been prevented or deprived of such a personation, and it is punishable up to 3 years with or without fine. So this is another thing is 206 is concealing the property from preventing it from seizure. So for example, it may be the, again it may be the property suit, or it may be the money suit, or it may be anything which relates to forgery or misappropriation of property. They know very well that they are going to get back the property, or the person who is going to get the order in their favor. So at the time what they are doing, either it may be by the concerned person, And 207 speaks about if it is done by the another person. So 206 வந்து அவங்களே அந்த ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி அவங்களுக்கு கிடைக்க கூடாது அப்படிங்கிற இன்டென்ஷனோட அத வந்து கன்சீல் பண்றது, ட்ரான்ஸ்ஃபர் பண்றது இல்ல வேற யாருக்காவது டெலிவர் பண்றது அந்த மாதிரி இருக்கலாம். 207 வந்து வேற ஒருத்தர் மத்தவங்களோட ப்ராப்பர்ட்டிக்காக பண்றது. So இங்க என்ன பண்றாங்கன்னா fraudulently removes that property. So here it includes movable and immovable. So immovable in the sense that's what they state that transfer or deliver to any other person. So there is no discrimination or there is no any clarity whether it speaks about movable or immovable. Na from the terms used in the definition part we can take into consideration that it includes both movable and immovable. With respect to removes and conceals we can take it as movable property. With respect to transfer or delivers we can take it as immovable property. Any property or interest, that's what I told you, any property or interest in the property. So transferring the title interest to other to prevent that if the property may leads to any seizure for the default of payment of fine or for the default of any other purpose or setting back the property to the original owner, for all these things. So it may be relates to seizure, which relates to default of property, of fine, and includes the fourth feature of property also. And the sentence pronounced or likely to be pronounced. Appo idu da ange mukkiyamaanadhu inge solrom illaya. For example, this thing. So pronounced or likely to be pronounced is an important element for section 206. So here it is not simply the preventing that or transferring that, but here the pronounced, here it is speaks about to, I'm expecting who, the person who is changing or the person who is converting or the person who is transferring that property is expecting that there may be the judgment, there may be the pronouncement that there may be the payment of fine and other thing, which is punishable up to 2 years with or without fine. So here you could see taken in execution of decree or order. So from the wordings used in the elements of the crime, we can derive it includes immovable property also. So epome adha nam vandu criminal law porutha varaikkum adinudaiya elements padikkum bodhu literal translation edukave koodadhu. You should not take the literal translation or literal understanding of the particular section. We have to interpret it. So criminal law, it may be the punishment or the element, we have to try to interpret. So inga nama enna interpret panikiram, it includes both movable and immovable property. So 207 is continuation. If I am delivering the property to other and if the other person receives the property with the intention, which intention? To prevent the property from seizure. So I am delivering the property to Mr. B with the intention to prevent the seizure, and Mr. B receives the property with the same intention to prevent the property from seizure. அப்ப நான் வந்து பிக்கு வந்து ஒரு ப்ராப்பர்ட்டியை என்ன பண்றேன், டெலிவர் பண்றேன். அது என்ன மாதிரி ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி? அது ஃபைனுக்கு இப்போ எடுத்து கான்ஃபிஸ்கேட் பண்ண போறாங்க, இல்ல ஃபோர்த் ஃபீச்சர் ஆஃப் ப்ராப்பர்ட்டிக்கு அது எடுத்துக்க போறாங்கன்னு தெரிகிற ஒரு ப்ராப்பர்ட்டியை, அந்த ஃபோர்த் ஃபீச்சர் ஆஃப் ப்ராப்பர்ட்டியோ இல்ல அந்த எக்ஸிக்யூஷன் அந்த டிகிரியோ ப்ரிவென்ட் பண்றதுக்காக நான் என்ன பண்றேன், என்னுடைய ப்ராப்பர்ட்டியை பிக்கு டெலிவர் பண்றேன். அப்ப பி என்ன பண்றாரு, அந்த சேம் இன்டென்ஷனோடய எங்கிட்ட இருந்து வாங்குறாரு. இப்ப பிக்கு வந்து அந்த இன்டென்ஷன் இல்ல, அந்த நாலேஜ் இல்லைன்னா 207 அங்க அப்ளை ஆகாது. இஃப் மிஸ்டர் பி ரிசீவ்ஸ் த ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி ஃப்ரம் மீ வித்வுட் சச் இன்டென்ஷன் ஆர் நாலேஜ், வாட் இன்டென்ஷன் அண்ட் நாலேஜ் ஹியர் ஃபார் ப்ரிவென்டிங் த ப்ராப்பர்ட்டி ஃப்ரம் சீஷர், இஃப் ஹீ இஸ் இஃப் த இன்டென்ஷன் இஸ் ஆப்சன்ட், பி வில் நாட் கம் வித்இன் த ஆம்பிட் ஆஃப் செக்ஷன் 207. பட் இஃப் இட் இஸ் கம்ஸ் வித் த இன்டென்ஷன், ஹீ இஸ் கமிங் வித் இன் த ஆம்பிட் ஆஃப் செக்ஷன் 207. And 208 is the again the relevancy. So here it speaks about, so here it speaks about dishonestly making a false claim in the court. So we have come across several type of this in the Motor Vehicles Act for accident claim, for MCOP cases, and sometimes it may be in the family court cases also for, while claiming this maintenance and other thing. So making false claim before the court. So where the person is not eligible for that claim. So for example, if we take in case of MCOP, motor vehicle accident claim cases, he might have been suffered only injury which is not proportionate with the amount what he has claimed. Suppose he has claimed rupees 10 lakhs, but what he has spent is only 2 lakhs. So, but here making such a statement or making such a claim which is not fit for him, or making such a false claim before the court to receive or to injure some other person, which is punishable with 2 years with or without fine. So again, I'm stressing, what is the difference between this particular chapter with the entire of the other chapter is, here the person who is aggrieved because of the any judgment passed by the court on the basis of false evidence only has to give a complaint. It has to be examined, then only these provisions will come. So the prosecution or the court will not frame the charges based on the offenses covered from section 191 to 229A. So only the aggrieved person has to give the complaint. And the 211 is about making or framing false charge with intention to injure. So here it includes both giving false complaint with the intention to injure and making false charge with the intention to injure. So it includes both. So causing any injury. So example for this is several 498A cases, cruelty by husband, and several cases comes under the Dowry Prohibition Act, Domestic Violence Act, because these act now recently, Protection of Women from Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act also. So because these act prescribe specific provision when it comes to know that the complaint is false, or complaint has been given with an ulterior motive, or complaint has been given to injure the person, it is also punishable. So here it covers under section 211 also. I'm giving the complaint with an intention to injure the person where the person is innocent who has not committed that. And based on the complaint, if any false charge has been made out or any illegal ground or without any justification, any charge has been made, the person who gives such a, who make such a false charge or who gives such a false complaint covered under section 211 and which is punishable up to 7 years if the offense is punishable with a death. So here the punishment is from 7 years to 2 years. Maximum is 7 years and minimum is 2 years. And section 212 speaks about harboring offender. I told you already, it includes harboring of offender also. So what do you mean by this harboring offender is concealing, not only concealing. If you check out the definition for harbor under section 52A of the Indian Penal Code, it speaks that either concealing, facilitating, facilitating to transportation, facilitation for conveyances, making the person to hide, and this harboring will not cover within the spouses. That is the exception given in section 52A itself. So here 212 speaks about harboring of an offender. So whoever harbors or conceals any person with the knowledge and intention and have reason to believe that the person is an offender of some offense. He has committed an offense and with an intention to screen the person from the legal punishment. So for example, for this case is in Rajiv Gandhi assassination case, when the remaining persons, the last 3 person who has been encountered in Huzur, the house owner who gave the house for rent for this person has covered under section 212. I think there was a movie based on this, the last moment of the person who hid themselves in Huzur, and the house owner who gave the house for them covered under this section 211, because it is the harboring of offender by knowing, with the intention or with the knowledge, whoever provides such a harboring coming under section 211. And the three types of punishments has been prescribed under this. If the offenses relating to offense punishable up to death sentence, the punishment is up to 5 years. And if it is imprisonment for life or imprisonment up to 10 years, the punishment is 3 years. And for the other offenses, which is less than 10 years, it is 1/4 of the maximum sentence provided for that offense comes under this harboring. And 213 and 214 has to read together, which speaks about taking and offering gift to screen an offender from punishment. So one is taking. Another one is offering, just like dowry, offering and demanding, both are punishment. In such a way, taking and offering gift to screen an offender. Appo 212 nam enna paathom harboring paathom, 213 and 214 and the harbor pandrathukku offer pandratho illa harbor pandrathukku edhavadhu vaangratho in turn return vaangratho andha madhiriyanadhukku punishment da section 213 and 214. So either it may be agreed or attempt to accept or agree to accept any gratification for himself or any other person, restitution of property in consideration of what? Restitution of property is giving back the property to the person for what? For the purpose of concealing or screening any offender from legal punishment. So here, three elements are most important. One is the person must be an offender, and the person who is harboring having the knowledge and reason to believe that he is an offender. And third one, he is providing such a concealment to prevent that person to appear for the any legal proceedings, punishments. So punishment is 7 years, 10 years and 5 years. And the next one is about the harboring of offender escaped from custody or apprehension is ordered. Apprehension is arrest. Any NBW, non-bailable warrant has been issued, or any other warrant has been issued, or any person who escaped from the custody, either from the prison or from the police custody or from judicial custody. So and the type of offenders ku harbor pandrathu appa 212 213 214 any offender ah irukla adhaadu arrest ay agala offense commit pannittu inna absconding la irukravangalukku kudukra harboring but 216 edhu escape aana already offense commit panni arrest aayittu prison la irukranga illa custody la irukanga illa or warrant issue pannirukanga andha mari offenders ku enna kudukradhu harbor pandrathu. So whoever escapes from the custody, or a person who has been convicted, or who has been charged and facing trial, or being in a lawful custody. So either convict prisoner, or the under trial prisoner, or maybe the remand prisoner. So moonu perume ulla vandranga 216 la. And whoever been escapes from such custody, the person who is escaped from such custody. And whoever harbors or conceals such person with knowledge or reason to believe or intention of preventing him from being apprehended. So enna pandranga inga harbor ko conceals ko, so his intention is to prevent that person from being apprehended. From being apprehended means from being arrested. So arrest pandrada prevent pananum abingira purpose ko. So punishment, what I told you in 212, 213 and 214 will cover the same for the 216 also. So 216A is a new amended section which speaks about penalty for harboring offenders relating to robbery and dacoity. So robbery ko dacoity offense commit panna or offender vandu enna pandrathu harbor pandrathu. Harbor in the sense concealing them. So knowingly or under the belief harbors any person who has been the offender, who has either committed or recently committed any robbery, or who is going to or about to commit. Upon the conspiracy involved, he may be involved in the conspiracy, or he may have the reason to believe that the person is going to commit a robbery. So for these types of person, if whoever gives any concealment or screen the person or facilitate the person, so idu ellame edhila vandru namakku 216A la vandru. And section 217 and 218 has to be again read together, which speaks about the offenses committed by the public servant with respect to false evidence. So here, one is either disobeying the direction of law or framing wrong records, what with the intention to save a person from punishment or forfeiture of property. So if any eviction order has been passed, and if any bailiff has been issued with the order to go and evict the premises, but he failed that or disobeying that order, for what? To save the person from such a forfeiture of property. Or if any non-bailable warrant has been issued and such a non-bailable warrant has been evaded or not executed with the purpose of either the saving the person from punishment or any legal proceedings. So it exclusively applies to public servant alone, and that to the public servant who is having the authority of executing such a direction of law or framing the record. So the punishment here is up to 7 years and 3 years. For 217, it is 3 years, and 218, it is 7 years. And 219 is commitment or confinement contrary to law. This provision speaks about the judicial officers, because committal proceedings, committing a case to the appropriate jurisdictional court or setting the case to the particular trial court, this thing only done by the presiding officer or the judicial officer. So here it says that any person by the authority of law having power to commit a person for a trial or any commitment or any confinement. So sending a person to any confine or any custody or any detention, whoever acting maliciously or correctly exercise that authority in contrary to law is punishable under section 219 with imprisonment not less than 7 years. So 210 la nam committal proceedings paapo, 210 CRPC la. So cognizance of offense mudichittu, examination of private complaint and the examination of witness mudichittu, okay idu vandu ennoda jurisdiction la varadhu, idu session jurisdiction da pogum appdin therinju onnu adu anupama irukiradhu illa adupa vendiya case anupuradhu idellame namakku edhila vandrum 219 la vandrum. Appo and the judicial officer mele yaar complaint kudupa, யாருக்கு அகெயின்ஸ்டா இந்த மாதிரி மலீஷியஸா இல்ல ராங்ஃபுல்லா இல்ல கரெக்டடா இந்த கமிட்மெண்ட்டையோ இல்ல கன்ஃபைன்மெண்ட்டையோ பண்ணாங்களோ அவங்களுக்கு அகெயின்ஸ்டா என்ன பண்ணலாம், இந்த 219 கம்ப்ளைண்ட்டை சப்மிட் பண்ணலாம்.